This video is brought to you by the University Writing Center, a unit of the Department of Rhetoric and Writing at the University of Texas at Austin. You can contact us at uwc.utexas.edu.
Today, I'm going to be talking about common challenges of graduate level work, specifically writing the dissertation, and then really focusing on some solutions, both in the kind of broader context that are generally applicable to most people, and then finding ways to cultivate solutions that work in your particular context. So some systematic challenges that most graduate writers see, and of course not always, but most, tend to be cultural, institutional, pedagogical, and then of course we have to talk about our current context over the past year and a half or 2 years and the ways that's affected our individual lives, but then also the kind of work that you all are doing as scholars. So we're gonna go through each of these and kind of break down what they mean and what they look like. So some cultural challenges, some perfectionism and imposter syndrome, you're probably familiar with those terms, a sense of high stakes and sunk costs, and oftentimes an outdated writing process. So perfectionism and imposter syndrome, you know, most of the time graduate students are very smart and very capable and did excellent undergraduate work and are admitted to graduate schools on all those qualifications. And there can be an external but also internally imposed expectation to be a star in your field and to do it and to know how to do it perfectly right from the get-go. And then when you don't meet those expectations, you can feel like an imposter, like you don't deserve to be here, or that you have to fake it until you can try to somewhat understand what's going on or what you're doing. This is very, very common, and it can be quite difficult to navigate through those feelings and still be productive in terms of your writing projects. Farther along in graduate school, there are oftentimes high stakes and sunk costs. You know, if you're looking to apply to academic jobs, you know, the dissertation is a step towards that. It can be difficult to change a project in later stages, and it is certainly difficult to walk away because of the sunk costs, time away from family, living within certain income levels, various sacrifices that you will make to be here and to do this work. And then lastly, outdated writing process oftentimes refers to the kinds of advice that you may be getting from faculty or even from colleagues who are writing 5 years ago. You know, the conditions 10 years ago, 5 years ago for writing a dissertation and doing graduate work are very different. They've changed and shifted pretty substantially even in the past year and a half when there have been budget cuts, the lockdowns on international travel and the accessibility to higher education for international students. Even in the best of conditions, you know, things change and we might be getting advice based on previous ways of doing it. And that can make our work more difficult if that advice doesn't take into account the ways in which things have shifted or changed. So kind of to boil that down, and this is not to demoralize you guys in any way, that really what we're trying to do here is to identify things that sometimes people feel like, gosh, I'm alone in this, this must be me, this must be my fault, I'm not a good graduate student. I can almost say with certain confidence, no, it's not. It's because these are challenges that most people face. And to boil that down, oftentimes graduate students don't feel like they can try, fail, and try again. And certain institutional pressures may exacerbate that feeling, especially if you have limited time and funding and are being pressured to finish the degree as soon as possible. So on that note, some institutional challenges, limited time and funding. You can be receiving opaque or even shifting expectations. I've worked with graduate students before who said their advisors kept shifting the goalposts in terms of like, oh, I want your chapter to do this, or I have these expectations for the data that you're collecting. And because they're coming from the advisor, the graduate student defers to that, right? But then it's still this ongoing process of trying to meet those expectations, and there's a lot of frustration that can build up. Limited and siloed resources that can be within departments or within the UT as the bigger institution. And these things can breed feelings of competition and isolation. So this might even be, you know, certain departments are pretty well funded. Graduate students receive teaching. Those are forms of income that can help sustain this work. Other departments are not as well funded, right? And then if you go out and apply for grants and other forms of funding, that can, like I said, breed competition and isolation there as well. So oftentimes we may not feel like we have support and camaraderie. You know, we talk a lot about in graduate school, kind of demystifying this idea of the graduate student as a lone wolf, as someone who, or the solitary genius who can do this work alone and just has all of these brilliant ideas. And hopefully that is being recognized as a myth. And, you know, people are turning more and more to forms of community, wherever we may find them, you know, whether that be in a writing group amongst friends in your department, or a writing group at the Writing Center, or even just, you know, other organizations on campus that make you feel like you have a network of people and resources that are all going to help lift you up and sustain you through this process. Okay. Some pedagogical challenges. I mentioned sometimes that we may not be receiving the most updated information or advice from faculty advisors. There is also a lot of flawed how-to advice out there, a lot of published material that can do this as well. You all have probably seen books like How to Write Your Dissertation in 15 Minutes a Day, which, not to criticize those things, those can be very, very valuable resources. But I would caution, you know, over investing in anything like that, because that might not be the right fit for you. And again, like say you try to write your dissertation in 15 minutes a day and it's not quite working for you. The risk there is that, again, that you're going to take it as a kind of reflection on your own skills and abilities, when really it's maybe just not the best method for you. A lot of advisors have received little to no training on how to be effective advisors, you know, and this is no fault of their own, but something in which doesn't necessarily benefit graduate student writers. Again, there are a few courses, or if any, on academic writing. I think the basic assumption when you're admitted to graduate school is that you're a proficient writer, and most people are, right? The problem with that, though, is that, you know, oftentimes you are being asked to write materials that, one, you've never written before, but probably also never read before. And so without models, either dissertation or thesis models, it can be, you can feel like you kind of just have to stumble into it, or it's a process of trial and error, which eventually it will probably get done, but it can be demoralizing and frustrating in that process. So we may not feel like we have effective mentorship. And again, these things are not true of everyone. You know, you may be thinking my advisor is amazing, and others you might be thinking like, oh, that kind of feels a little familiar, right? There is so much variation and there's so many different conditions. And again, that's why, you know, this is not going to be this workshop series and this workshop today is not going to be this kind of like one-stop solution, but really just trying to kind of give you a vocabulary, kind of sense of what you're dealing with, so that you can then go cultivate your own solutions as best you can. Okay. And then the last year, fun times, right? COVID-19, the shutdown, campus shutdown. It changed the way that we could visit the library. There for a while, the library wasn't even open, you know? This might affect how you can get resources, how you share resources and books. If you're doing any kind of archival research, that was probably put to a hard stop. I've worked with students whose entire projects had to come to an end because they couldn't go out and do field work. And it was a real process of grief and kind of coming to terms with the grief that they couldn't do the project they wanted to. On top of that, movements for racial and social justice, Black Lives Matter, the incidents of police brutality that captured national attention last year and was a source of chronic stress and anxiety for a lot of people. On top of that, the Zoom fatigue and social isolation and that many of us have experienced by working from home and doing remote learning. And then just on personal level, you might have been taking care of yourself, but also caretaking of others, some of whom may have been very ill, either from COVID or from other things that happen in the course of everyday life. So just want to, of course, acknowledge and make space for the fact that even today in doing this workshop via Zoom, we are bringing a lot of our own lived experiences to the dissertation, to graduate work, to conferences and workshops like this, and to try to not try to avoid them or to dismiss them, but to address them with grace and to give ourselves grace in doing so. Okay. So before I continue on, because I realize I'm moving pretty quickly here, I want to offer a pause. And if anyone wants to comment or ask a question at this point, we are transitioning now, though, to some solutions to these problems. So hopefully I haven't bummed you out too much so far. Anyone want to add anything to that or ask any questions or articulate any other concerns or other kinds of challenges that you've experienced as a graduate student? Okay. Some solutions. We're going to be talking here in this next section about how to consider your audience, how to set goals, how to manage your advisors, which I think some people might take as a kind of saucy term, like up managing, if you guys have ever heard of this term, using models, and then of course, taking care of yourself. So consider audience. So this is something that we talk a lot about at the Writing Center, and it's really kind of a caveat for the rest of the advice that we give. So we really want to encourage you to think about who your audience is. And that might have several different realms. It's really asking yourself, who do you have to speak to and whose language do you need to use in doing so? So of course you are your audience, right? This is your project. This is something that you are investing a lot of time into, making a big commitment to. So you should be writing to yourself and your interest in using the language and tone and style that you are most comfortable with. You are also writing and speaking to your advisor and your committee, some of whom might have very particular expectations of the kind of dissertation you're writing or how to write it. Others might be a little bit more hands-off, right? And there are benefits and advantages to both. You're also speaking to your department and institution, and then of course to your discipline or field. So this is really, really where we see the biggest change between undergraduate level writing and graduate level work, right? Undergrads, you're writing your seminar papers, your course papers, you're speaking, you're using the language of your class, you're speaking to your professor or other faculty member or instructor. Graduate level work, you might be speaking to a committee on a grant application, some of whom might be in your field of research, some of whom may not, right? So then that's going to shape the kind of language that you use in terms of how much jargon you might drop in or the kind of terms that you might throw around. If you are submitting an article to a journal, you're going to probably want to read that journal and figuring out, okay, what are some of the rhetorical moves that these writers are making? What makes an article sound like it's a good fit for this publication? Publications always have a kind of identity or like even a kind of persona that they're crafting. And so they're going to want to make sure that your work fits in within, brand might be the more accurate term there. So this is, just encouraging you all to be mindful. Who do you have to speak to? Who are you writing to? Whose needs and expectations do you have to consider in doing this work? And realizing that they may shift according to the type of document that you're writing, and then even potentially at the stage of development of your project. Okay, so, and I've mentioned this before, so you're gonna wanna cultivate solutions that work in your context. Again, so this might be your discipline, this could be your department, this could be working with a particular faculty advisor, and then of course what you need and want to do as a scholar. In terms of setting goals, what we recommend is, you know, setting goals that are both personal and that meet institutional timelines. So another marked change between undergraduate level work and that of graduate school is, you know, graduate level writing projects are typically and by largely like self-managed, right? You know, you are not necessarily getting a rubric or instructions or deadlines. Those are things that you need to set for yourself, you know, and so, you know, this might be seminar papers for the dissertation. There might be like the end timeline, like you need to graduate after a year or 2 years, or this is when your funding runs out, but you're going to have to break down that bigger chunk of time and impose your own timelines and set deadlines. I do strongly recommend that you consult departmental graduate coordinators if you haven't already. Get to know your graduate coordinator. They are there to help you and to share resources. And it's typically a good idea to be on friendly terms with your graduate coordinator. These are also the people that will distribute email announcements, notices of workshops, and certainly distribute important information to your program. You can also visit the graduate school degree evaluators. For those of you who might be a little bit farther along in the process, they're the ones that are going to help you with templates and formatting and submission guidelines of the dissertation, applications for graduation. So certainly get to know them then. But even if you're in the earlier stages, it's probably a good practice to go ahead and get a sense of what is coming down the line, right? And who these people are and what they do. And so the link in the subsequent bullet point will take you directly to resources and some instructions on graduation. This next point, something that works for a lot of people that we really like to do here at the Writing Center is to plan backwards from graduation. And so Laura is going to drop into the chat a handout on something called back planning. And once that goes through, we can open it up and take a look and discuss. Good, thanks Laura. So back planning is, you know, basically defines itself. It's just starting with, in setting your timelines with that final deadline. So say, you know, you have to submit the dissertation by like April 1st for a May graduation. I think that'd actually be a little late, but that's just the date that came to my mind right now. So now you have to submit it by April 1st. So then you set April 1st as the submission. And then you're like, okay, well, I really want my full committee to be able to read the draft and to provide comments on it and give me some feedback. Like, okay, well, I know from working with them and from what they've said, the turnaround time on any feedback is probably going to be about 2 to 3 weeks. So, okay, so if I factor in 2 to 3 weeks for the turnaround time, and then I want to give myself 2 weeks to deal with those comments and to do those revisions, then I need to get that to them, you know, 5 weeks before the submission. So I think you guys are probably getting a fair sense of how this works. Like any kind of goal setting, it is an estimate, right? Like maybe your advisor will get it back to you in a week. Maybe they'll take 2 months. Maybe they'll disappear for 4 months. There are a lot of uncertainties and things that you cannot predict in this, but it does help you to kind of get a sense of like, okay, this is typically, these are the patterns that I've seen, and this is what I know I need. You know, maybe you get comments back from an advisor and you know you can deal with them and crank it out in 2 days. Other people might need 2 weeks. So just knowing yourself and knowing what you need and what you like to do, you know, give yourself the time to do that. And then you start working backwards and you go farther back, and then you get a sense of when you need to start and the kinds of milestones that ideally you will be making as you make progress towards this final deadline. And then lastly on this slide, reflecting and adjusting with your advisor. I feel like some of the work that I do is just some permission granting and trying things out, right? You know, like try back planning, try setting that goal for yourself of, you know, dealing with revisions in 2 weeks. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work, give yourself 3 weeks, right? You know, and so making those kinds of adjustments is a very natural and expected part of this process. It can be very, very helpful to even schedule kind of check-ins with your advisor. So they might be able to even provide feedback, not just on the chapter draft or whatever you're showing them, but also your project management and your process, right? And they can maybe offer some suggestions or advice on how to strengthen that process. So two methods for goal setting. I think a lot of people are very familiar with these. They're pretty widely used these days. And Laura is going to share handouts for both in the chat. So we have SMART and WHOOP. So SMART is a lovely acronym for specific, measurable, actionable, reasonable, and time-bound. And the handout that she's sharing with you is you can actually just go in and I think if you click on it, maybe download it to your own computer and then you can either print it out, which who even owns a printer these days? I don't even know. But you can hopefully fill it out on your computer or even upload it to a Google Doc and do it there. It's just a way of making sure that you are setting yourself up for success. You know, so rather than say this summer, I'm going to write a chapter. Well, that's a fantastic goal and I support that 100%. But let's break that down, right? So maybe a smarter goal in this context, so something more specific and measurable, be like, okay, I want to write a chapter this summer. So that means I have, let's say 10 weeks to do it. Okay, well then I've kind of proposed maybe 4 sections to this chapter. So that means I have like 2.5 weeks per section, right? Like, okay, well then if I have 2.5 weeks per section, then I want to draft maybe 4 pages a day or 4 pages a week. You do the math if that helps you. A lot of people find that to be really helpful in terms of either breaking down like, okay, I've got 10 weeks to write a 50-page chapter, so I need to produce that number of pages a day. Or setting word count goals is another kind of smart tool because it's measurable, right? Like, okay, I'm going to write 500 words a day. And they don't necessarily have to be amazing, put it in concrete, publish it, share it with the world kind of words, but they're going to be 500 words that give me something to work with the following day. So those are smaller goals that lead in and create and pave the way towards the bigger goal of writing the chapter, right? And I think really importantly, especially for this work, is making sure that they're time bound. You know, do set some deadlines for yourself. And again, those deadlines, sometimes you won't make them, sometimes you will, and we can reflect and adjust the process when that happens. But if you just say, yeah, I'm gonna write a chapter over the next couple of months, then that's where we start to kind of get into that slippery slope where it becomes just really easy to make negotiations with our time, even if we've like set it aside for writing, or that old procrastination friend kicks in. Right. And so giving that sense of, okay, this task, this part of my project, I want it to have this kind of duration can be really helpful. I personally really like the WHOOP goal setting sheet. for a couple of reasons. So it asks you to identify the wish, the obstacle, the outcome, and then a plan. And again, you can do WHOOP on all different kinds of levels. So I mean, like on the biggest, most general level, your WHOOP might be, well, I want to finish graduate school. I want to get my PhD and I want to get out of here, right? That's my wish. What is the obstacle? Well, I'm tired. I'm kind of bored. I don't know what to do with my project. And I haven't talked to my advisor in 6 months, right? You know, but then you start to envision the outcome and then coming up with a plan, right? And so I really like this because it helps on a kind of macro and micro level for if, when thinking. So if my advisor doesn't get back to me in a timely way with feedback, I'm going to send my materials to this person, right? So, and again, you ideally you have more than one person who is reading your work as you're writing, you know, and that can either be writing consultants, that can be friends or colleagues, maybe other people in the department that are on your committee or off your committee, right? So if my advisor doesn't get back to me in a timely way, I'm going to share my work with this person and get feedback from them. It also can be just really personal for the things that you know that you struggle with. You know, like if I'm sitting at my computer and I'm just dragging and I don't want to do it, and I find myself turning to YouTube to find funny cat videos, I'm going to turn off my internet, or like I'm going to disable the Wi-Fi for an hour. So I'm going to have to sit here and I'm going to have to look at this blank Microsoft Word page and put something down. So that plan is really, really nice in terms of finding the action that you can take to navigate through that obstacle as best you can. So hopefully those two things are useful for you. And again, I might play with it and do it on different levels, both kind of like you could do a WHOOP, like in terms of like institutional expectations and pressures, personal struggles, anything you like. Okay. So we always want to set goals that promote achievement. And so you guys have probably heard that expression, you know, I think I even used it, set yourself up for success, right? So, just want to caution against things like, I really want to be done. I'm feeling really good right now. I'm going to write 2 chapters in a month, right? Which full speed ahead if that's really what you want to try to do. But if you don't meet that goal, it can do some damage, right? And so we want you to stay the course, sustain yourself, sustain some really good generative momentum, and then to enjoy what you're doing. You know, the work that graduate students get to do is pretty cool, right? And I speak from experience, like, I wish I had enjoyed it more than I had, right? Because it's different on the other side. But this is all saying that we want you to thrive and to do well. And so just keeping in mind what you need, what you're capable of, and then the things that you're dealing with, set goals that promote achievement. Okay. Is everybody okay with the pace that I'm going at? Like, are we okay? Okay. I noticed in Zoom now there's a slow down reaction button. Thank you for the thumbs up. Cool. Okay. So the next bit of advice is to be proactive with advisors. I think sometimes grad students can think like, okay, well, if my advisor really wants to see my work, she'll ask me for it or she'll email me for it. And that's going to be rare, I think. You know, faculty advisors are teaching. They're doing their own research. They're probably serving on multiple dissertation committees and doing other kind of departmental work. They're very busy people. So if you think like, oh, well, I haven't heard from them, so that means that they don't really want to see anything, so I'll just, you know, I'll wait a couple more weeks. Assume nothing. You know, if you haven't heard from them and you expected to, reach out and say like, hi, how's it going? Let's check in, right? And then all throughout the process, you know, try to request and clarify expectations as best you can. And that can be difficult. Like it, and I don't want to diminish the difficulty of doing this in any way, because it can be scary. It can, you can receive no reply, or you can see receive lots of really great feedback and advice. But we do try to be proactive with your advisor. So in requesting and clarifying expectations, it's my, in like in terms of drafting an email, it's my understanding that, you know, or like we agreed to meet and talk about this section of my chapter or this chapter at this date. Does that date still work for you? Or, hi, I'm busy at work this summer. Here's what I have planned. Here are my goals for the summer. I'd love to check back in with you in August when we return for the fall semester. Another thing is to agree on committee members' roles. Not all members have to play the same role, you know? And so you can ask what their preferences are, you know, and be like, would you rather read things closer to the end, you know, kind of more than near the final stages of revision when things are pretty polished and put together? Or can I send you early drafts that might be a little messier, but are really where I could use a conversation about my ideas and the argument that I'm building, you know? And so maybe you have one person that will read that early messy stuff, and then you have another person who's kind of more near the end. Or if you're doing theory, you know, here's someone who can really help you with theory, and here's someone who can really help you with a lab report, or, you know, you have someone on your committee who just loves lit reviews, you know, like just try to identify what you can ask them for and what role they can play. And you propose timetables. Here's what I want to do. Here's what I want the semester to look like. Here are the goals that I'm setting for myself. What do you think? What's your response to this, right? I'd like to send you a draft of this on this date. Is it okay, or do you think that you could provide feedback to me within about a 2 to 3 week turnaround time, right? They can always say no, but they can also say yes. Right. And so if you're asking for your advisor's time and attention, make it easy for them to say yes. Send regular reminders and updates. And again, like you might have someone on your committee who's just like, I don't need all of this. Like, I don't need to be reminded of what you're working on, or what's happening, or the conferences that you went to. But they might, again, like they might really like to hear from you and just, you know, not have to seek that out from you, but instead for it to be delivered to them. And then working with revisions, and this is a good practice when you're coming to a meeting with an advisor that's talking specifically about revisions to your project. Or if you might even, like I've worked with some people that made really substantial changes to a chapter, and then the advisor was like, I didn't ask for this. And they're like, oh yes, you did. And I have the emails here in which we talked about making these changes. And so that's what I mean by provenance, right? So kind of trying to keep a sense of the conversations that you have, the suggestions for revision that have been made, and then how you dealt with them. You are the writer of your project, right? And so another thing that I oftentimes hear from graduate students is just this feeling of pressure that they just have to do exactly what their advisor tells them to. But if you feel really strongly about an idea or an argument or a data set or something in your dissertation, and you don't want to make those changes, then it's up to you to kind of make a case for that, right? And I would recommend doing so. So in subsequent meetings with your advisor, you can say, like, I really thought about this. I really thought and processed your suggestions. I really feel committed to doing it this way, and here's why, right? And so you can kind of make a case or make an argument for not listening or not addressing or incorporating those changes. Okay. So be respectful, of course, of your advisors, of their expertise, of their time, but then also be proactive. Please don't wait for them to come to you or to seek you out. Another thing that can be really, really helpful is to use models. So not very many people have their video on. I was gonna do like by a show of hands, but that's not gonna quite work. Go look for dissertations, right? Or like, so you may have gotten the advice, you know, if you're looking to publish an article in a particular journal, go read that journal, right? Do that for dissertations as well. You can ask your advisors, you know, for former advisees that have been or that are willing to share their work. You know, all dissertations are in the UT library. You know, sometimes graduate students will put an embargo on their dissertations, and this is likely if they're trying to turn their dissertation to a book, and so don't want too much of that research and writing out in the world before they do so. But embargoes, I think they typically have like a 6-year time limit. I'm not quite sure about that. But there are a lot of dissertations available for you to peruse. You can also ask your graduate coordinators and peers. And then right there on our slide is the web address for how to find them through the UT library. So when I say go read dissertations, I don't mean read them from cover to cover. Because as fascinating as they might be, you probably don't have time for that. And you don't necessarily want to get too deep into someone else's thinking or their content or their material. But what you can do is go in and just get a sense of how it's put together, right? Okay, how many chapters are there? How many sections within those chapters are there? How long are the chapters? Take a look at the introduction and like, okay, well, what are the moves that this person makes in putting the introduction together? Where is the lit review? Like, where does that come? Taking a look at the bibliography, you know? So just thinking about structure, style, perhaps, but more so just thinking like, what are some usable templates or like just forms or structures that I can get from reading these things? Do look at more than one, because I would hate for you to go into the library and read like that one 600 page dissertation. And then that you think that that's what you need to be doing, because that again, guarantee you is an outlier, right? You know, so don't read that, but then also hopefully don't go to like the 50 page dissertation. I don't think that one would have passed, but you get the idea. Read a couple, try to get a sense of what are the patterns, what are the standards. You might even look up, you know, dissertations that have won awards, you know, and not to scare you or to intimidate you, but to think about like, okay, this is the kind of work that is getting noticed. And you can, again, strategically skim and take notes on format and structure. And then you can look at good, great, and okay examples. You all have probably heard that phrase, a good dissertation is a finished dissertation, which, you know, I both appreciate, but then also like, oh, don't say that. Because of course we want to set expectations for ourselves to do good work. But even if you go on to an academic career, the dissertation is a credentialing document, right? Like it shows that you are capable of creating a project, of doing the research and doing the writing and seeing that project through from inception to completion. And academic jobs very, very quickly, you know, even I think in cover letters these days, committees want to hear about what's next, right? Like, so the dissertation is done, what's next? What are your next projects? Or like, how are you turning this into a book? So to that end, it can be, you know, a good dissertation is a finished dissertation. Laura is going to share with you a handout called Reading Model Introductions. And what this does is just kind of give you some steps in when I say so, okay, like using models, and I talked a lot about like going in and looking for format and structure. If you are looking more for the kind of rhetorical moves, this handout can be really, really helpful. So in the most basic way, some of the more conventional rhetorical moves of a scholarly piece of writing in the introduction is, you know, you like describe the field. Here's this discipline, or here's this conversation or debate. And then you identify the gap, what's missing, what people have not talked about, or like how a method may not be the best fit for this particular investigation. And then your intervention, right? So that's what I mean by rhetorical moves, where you describe the, like the kind of status quo, you interrupt it with something that's missing or wrong or incomplete, and then you seek to address that gap. And so even knowing that those are like the kind of conventional moves that a lot of writers make can be really helpful for you in terms of drafting your own introduction. And so reading sample materials with that in mind and kind of knowing what to look for, you can get some practice and some more knowledge of how people have executed those moves. So don't be perfect, be generative, you know, and generative might look very different for different people, right? You know, and you might measure it in different ways. You know, generative might be a certain number of pages or words for some folks. Generative might be, I feel really good about being in academia today, and that is a good day for me, right? So think about what that means to you and work towards it. And lastly, you know, we've all heard of self-care. This work is a type of work that can be all-consuming. And it can feel very stressful because ostensibly, you know, you can be doing research and writing most of the time, right? And then so then if you're not doing it most of the time, you may feel guilty or whatever else, right? So you have to rest. And so as you're setting these goals and proposing tables mm-hmm. and timelines, make room for rest, make time for rest. If you're scheduling weekly writing sessions or daily writing sessions with yourself, I always recommend taking at least one full day off from writing in which you don't touch the dissertation. And, you know, if you're in like the final crunch period and you're really just driving towards graduation, that might not be possible. But if you're kind of working on sustaining some momentum over the long term, a day of rest is more than reasonable and very, very beneficial. So just trying to make sure that you make and protect time for pupils and activities that bring you joy, balance, and connection. And then lastly, you know, decide what role you want your dissertation or thesis to play in your professional development and to manage your expectations accordingly. You know, I've been working with more and more people who have very confidently decided that they don't want to apply for tenure track faculty jobs and don't want to pursue an academic position. And feel really good about that. And it does take a certain amount of pressure off of the dissertation, you know, and, but say you do want that, you know, and like you really do want that life and you want to be a professor and you want to live this, this kind of life, then, you know, knowing though that the dissertation is not a book can help you manage expectations there as well. And like I said, you know, in the end, the dissertation is a credentialing document, and that credentialing document can fully go on to support careers outside of academia as well. So kind of just taking a minute and checking in with yourself about, okay, what is it that I want the dissertation to do? What do I want it to be? And coming to that decision can hopefully help you find a kind of have a healthy relationship with your dissertation. A couple of years ago, I would joke with students, be like, are you friends with your dissertation? Are you enemies? Where are you right now in your relationship? They thought that was funny, but then didn't know how to answer. Okay, so we are just about at the top of the hour, but just to really quickly recap the presentation, find solutions that work for your context. Of course, try to find out, you know, and like really identify what your context is. Set goals to promote achievement, both at the personal and institutional level. Be proactive and respectful with advisors. Make it easy for them to say yes. Use models to help you along in this process, especially if you're getting started and you feel like you don't know what you're doing, right? Go take a look at what other people have done. I don't know if anyone like kind of had like raised their eyebrows about any questions of plagiarism. And I'm saying like, go read these dissertations, and I'm not saying go in and like borrow material. I'm advising, take a look at how they did it. And then lastly, of course, take care of yourself and your community, and support yourself in whatever ways you need. And then we will talk a little bit in the second hour about identifying the things that you can control and the actions that you can take, and then, you know, what you need help with or the things that need you need assistance with.